a 78, one second, a 78-year-old gentleman from a rural area in Shikaripura, which is about 20 kilometers away from a healthcare setup. A former farmer who now does his routine physical activity at home came to our outpatient department on wheelchair with chief complaints of weakness of bilateral lower limbs since 15 days, numbness of distal lower limbs since 15 days. He is a right-handed individual. The history was obtained from the patient and his son, and therefore I consider the history to be reliable.
Proceed.
History of presenting illness. The patient was apparently, yes. The patient was apparently well in his usual state of health. He could walk around without assistance and do his daily activities by himself. About 15 days ago, he found difficulty in walking, which he told was because his legs were weak. He walked and would need assistance of one person to walk. He says that this happened every time he tried to walk, with the walking distance without assistance being approximately the same every time. He also reported that his chappals would slip from his legs and he wouldn't be aware of it. He reported that the weakness in both his lower limbs started at the same time. Since about 5 to 6 days, he has been finding it difficult to get up from the squatting position, needing assistance. But he couldn't tell if he could feel the presence of his clothes above the level of his ankles bilaterally. Thus, he has had a 15-day history of bilateral lower limb weakness, which started off insidiously as a distal weakness, but now has proximal muscle weakness too, with distal muscle weakness being more compared to proximal. History of bilateral sensory deficits, that is feeling numb since about 15 days, onset being at about the same time or slightly later than the motor weakness, with query proximal progression, with no tingling, burning, pins and needle sensation. He couldn't tell if there was loss of pain and temperature in the area of numbness. Next slide, please. Difficulty gripping objects with the upper limb or doing overhead activities like combing, no sensory deficits in the upper limb, no history of breathlessness or orthopnea, no history of difficulty holding his neck in the upright position, no history suggestive of cranial nerve deficits, no history of swaying while walking. Next slide. No history of stiffness of the limb or flexor spasms, no history of bowel or bladder incontinence, no history of involuntary movements in the thigh or gluteal muscles, no history of root pain. Next slide, please. History of back symptoms of illness, no history of trauma to the back or fall from height, no history of fever, no history of preceding cough or coryzal symptoms or diarrhea, no history of recent vaccinations. Next slide.
Okay, I think we'll discuss the symptoms as you have presented, the presenting complaints. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You're audible, okay. Sir.
Yes, sir.
So when we assess a neurological symptom, when we see the analysis of the neurological symptom, the first and most important thing that we are supposed to get by the history is the nature of the illness. That's what you have taken a very detailed history here. So the nature of illness that is there. And the second thing we are possibly involved based on to find out what part of the nervous system is got involved. So these are the two things that we have to get based on your history. So what do you mean by nature of illness? Yes, Himanshu, can you tell me what is nature of illness?
Yes, sir. A nature of illness, like, do you mean the etiology of illness?
Okay, it could be the etiology or more in a generalized form. What sort of disease, what are we dealing with? So etiology would be the final thing possibly in that.
Yes, sir. Like we would want to know the onset of the illness.
Yeah,
it that's could what be I mean. Acute, subacute, or chronic.
Okay, so that's the first thing that we look for. Whether it's an acute, subacute, or a chronic.
Yes, sir.
So based on your history, what do you think this is? Is it an acute or a subacute?
This is a subacute, sir.
Okay, you say it's subacute, it's not acute. Why do you say it's subacute and not acute? What's the cutoff in neurology to say acute?
At 24 hours.
24 hours, it's sudden. Nah? When you say acute in neurology, it's generally 4 weeks. A disease that has onsetted and progressed and either improved or something within 4 weeks, we call it as acute. So whatever occurs within that time is acute. The common acute diseases that you have, what are the common acute diseases you know of in neurology?
Cerebrovascular accident.
Cerebrovascular accident, which is sudden. Okay. Any other? A patient with paraparesis, yes. What's the acute disease you want to think? Yes.
Traumatic transverse myelitis.
Okay, transverse myelitis.
Transverse myelitis.
Okay.
Yes. Then. Post-trauma neuropathy.
Okay.
Like post-trauma. Pons medullaris and cauda equina syndromes.
Okay, that's all. Acute spinal cord disease. Yes. Any other acute disease? A neuropathy which could be acute.
Guillain-Barré.
Okay, Guillain-Barré syndrome, isn't it? Acute inflammatory demyelinating. So all these diseases are considered as acute. Yes. So when you say acute, the disease has to progress and reach its maximum and recover within 4 weeks. 4 weeks to 8 weeks, we say it's a subacute. Anything more than 8 weeks, that's more than 2 or 3 months, we consider it as chronic. So here you have a patient who has an acute disease, not a subacute, okay? It's the onset and the progression, whatever has happened, yes, is acute now. So here we have an acute disease that is there. So by knowing what sort of disease is it, what sort of etiologies will it point out to? Supposedly I say this is acute, this is subacute, and this is chronic. When we say the etiology in our system in general, what does it help us in? So acute diseases are usually due to what? Pathological.
Vascular
causes, correct? Vascular pathology is acute. Any other pathology is acute?
Yeah. Infectious causes are acute.
Infections are generally subacute. Infections are generally subacute.
Okay.
Which is the other acute cause? One is vascular. Vascular by meaning stroke, isn't it? We are discussing about stroke when you say vascular. Yeah. The other etiology which can be acute?
Yes, sir.
Which one?
Trauma.
Trauma, truly does not come into the neurology part of it. It's more of it's a surgical part of it. You say Guillain-Barré syndrome, you said, isn't it? What is the pathology there?
Yeah, demyelination, but it will be usually recurrent.
That may be recurrent, yes. But the onset is always acute. So remember, when you say acute diseases, we are either talking about vascular, that means it's a stroke, or it's a demyelination, okay? So if you say the general neurological diseases are broadly classified into 5 categories. First is vascular, as in stroke. Second is demyelination. Third is infectious or inflammatory. Next you have space occupying lesions. And the last one is degenerative. Last sort of disorders are degenerative. So degenerative is always chronic. Your infectious, post-infectious, and space-occupying lesions are generally subacute. Whereas demyelination and vascular are acute diseases. So when you say an acute disease, we are talking about either a stroke or it is a demyelination. So this is an acute disease that you have. So is it stroke or is it demyelination? How do we further decipher it based on your history? Based on your history, how do you decipher it?
Stroke is usually unilateral to begin with.
That depends upon the vascular territory, isn't it? If the spinal cord is getting involved, it can be bilateral. Yes, any other specific thing for a stroke?
Yes,
stroke is sudden, isn't it? Stroke is sudden. It is sudden onset. Yes. Onset is always sudden. There may be a progression, but usually does not progress for a longer duration. It happens suddenly. Or acutely, very, very hyperacutely. It happens suddenly. Whereas demyelination generally has an insidious onset. Insidious onset. It keeps on going slowly. And here in your patient, it is quite an insidious onset. It is going on. So it's unlikely to be stroke. It's more likely to be a demyelination disease. So basically the nature of illness is clear based on your history or the duration of symptoms and how it has progressed. We would generally think it is a demyelinating disease that could be there. rare possibility of a space occupying still is possible in this patient. Okay. The next question that we are answering is, which part of the nervous system is getting involved in this patient? So when we say the nervous system is involved, so the basic difference that we have to do is it an upper motor neuron disease or a lower motor neuron disease? So based on your history, how do you differentiate whether it's a UMN or an LMN disease? Yes, Himanshu?
Yes, sir. A UMN lesion basically means that the lesion is above the AHC, so it will have symptoms based on the place involved. So okay. If suppose there is a motor weakness, there would be some cranial deficit or symptom suggestive of pontine involvement, brainstem involvement or cerebellar involvement.
Okay, that could then, be there in LMN also.
UMN will...
Cranial nerve involvement can happen in LMN also. So that does not differentiate. You can have a lesion in the cranial nerve, isn't it? Neuropathy in the cranial nerves, which can also involve the cranial nerve.
Yes.
So cranial nerve does not differentiate. What sort of weakness do you get in case of upper motor neuron disease? What happens to the tone?
Weakness.
Yeah, tone the tone is increased. Will be increased, isn't it? So history-wise, how do you get? You
increased.
Yeah, history-wise, you have told that very clearly, that this patient does not complain of
yes.
heaviness of limbs, isn't it? You said heaviness of limbs, or you said some other word I think you used. So if there is no heaviness in this
yes.
patient, then it's likely to be a LMN disease. So LMN disease, the patient will have no heaviness, whereas a UMN disease, generally heaviness is there. But again, remember, the upper motor neuron disease in an acute presentation presents with a stage of neuronal shock. So in such a state, they'll still have no heaviness. But if there is heaviness in your patient, and the patient says that there is heaviness of the limbs or stiffness of the limbs, it could be considered as an upper motor neuron disease. Okay, based on which part of the limb is involved, can you differentiate upper motor neuron or lower motor neuron?
Mm.
Which, whether it's distal, proximal, like that, can you differentiate? Upper motor neuron versus lower motor neuron?
Distal proximal.
Yes?
I think the anterior horn cell involvement usually is proximal weakness with fasciculation.
When you say UMN versus LMN, which is distal, which is proximal?
Okay. No, I don't know that, but usually UMN involves a group of muscles and LMN
correct.
Is like few muscles.
Okay, that's one thing. Okay, if it is asymmetrical, if it is involving a small group of muscles, it's more likely to be LMN. Whereas if it's the entire limb getting involved, it's more likely to be UMN. So please remember, UMN lesions are always distal predominant. Upper motor neuron disease is always distal. So supposedly somebody gets a stroke, the common upper motor neuron disease that we have, the weakness always will start distally and come towards the proximal. So please remember this. This is the rule. Upper motor neuron disease is always distal onset. The weakness is always distal starting, though it might become proximal very fast. Okay. So that's the first thing that you'd remember. So LMN disease are always proximal onset. When you say LMN, what does LMN include, Himanshu? From where does to what are the structures that come under LMN? Anterior horn cell.
The anterior horn cell.
Correct.
The peripheral nerve, neuromuscular the junction, and then the muscle.
Okay, that's okay. Between the anterior horn cell and the peripheral nerve? What comes out from the radicals? The roots are there, the radicals are there.
Yeah, the radicals, yeah. Roots.
Roots, radicals, plexus. All those things are the next part that you have. So remember, the lower motor neuron disease, be it an anterior horn cell disease, per se, or the radicular disease, or a muscle disease, or a neuromuscular junction disease, all are proximal. Their weakness always starts proximally and then progresses distally. The only exception that you have to remember is, which is an exception, which starts distally and then comes proximally, lower motor.
The Guillain-Barré.
Guillain-Barré is proximal. Guillain-Barré is proximal.
Okay.
Neuropathies, isn't it? Neuropathy. All neuropathies start distally, isn't it? Neuropathy, what's the why the nerves get involved in that fashion? Why it's always distal to proximal? why the weakness starts in the distal when the peripheral nerve is getting involved. The damage is always dependent on the length of the axon, isn't it? So the longer the axons will get damaged more faster, be it any of the pathology that could happen. So remember, all the neuropathies are distal in onset. So whenever a patient complains of weakness from the distal and coming towards the proximal, it is either a neuropathy or it is an upper motor neuron disease. Did you get that clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So all UMN diseases are distal, all LMN diseases are proximal, except neuropathy. Clear? Neuropathy is distal.
Sir.
Now, again, one exception you have to remember, as you said, Guillain-Barré syndrome or Guillain-Barré syndrome. Again, it is demyelination, isn't it? The pathology is demyelination. And where does the demyelination happen in your GB syndrome? Which part of the nervous system gets involved? Demyelination of the?
Yeah.
Is it the nerve alone or?
Anterior.
Not the anterior horn cell. It's the radicals.
No, the radicals are it.
So important, radicals. The radicals getting involved. So demyelinating of the radicals, that's why Guillain-Barré syndrome is proximal. So what did I tell you? All neuropathies are distal, but demyelinating neuropathies are proximal. So can you repeat and tell me what are the proximal diseases? What are the distal diseases?
The diseases are UMN and peripheral neuropathies, and proximal diseases LMN.
LMN and demyelinating neuropathies. All other neuropathies are distal. So when your patient complains of distal weakness, always starting from the distal and coming up, it's either a neuropathy or it's a UMN disease. Clear? So based on your history, you have weakness of the lower limbs, numbness in the distal part of the lower limbs, started distal. So based on your history, is it a distal predominant or it's a proximal predominant? I think in the next slide you're describing.
Distal predominant.
Can you change to the next slide? Yeah, you said distal. So what is that history that you got to suggest that it is distal?
His footwear would slip from his leg. That indicates distal motor neuropathy. He had difficulty his footwear after it slipped. That indicates distal motor involvement. And he wouldn't be...
The footwear slipping would indicate what? What weakness of which group of muscles? His chappals are slipping from the leg. Indicates what group of muscles are getting involved. Distal, correct? Which distal muscles? Slippage of chappals. Which are the muscles that are involved when you hold the chappals?
Of the toe.
Okay, flexors of the toe. Okay, adductors. Okay. Your extensor hallucis, your extensor digitorums, plantar flexors, okay, all of them would come predominantly. You said the patient was unaware that he had loss of chappals. So that does it mean only motor is involved or sensory is also involved?
It means sensory is also involved.
Sensory is also involved. Okay. You said that there was buckling of the knees somewhere. I thought so. You told that the knees would buckle or the legs would buckle. What would that suggest? Which muscles are you thinking of? Buckling of the knees.
That means he is not able to maintain extension of the knee. So it's quadriceps weakness.
Quadriceps weakness. Very important history to suggest quadriceps weakness. So there is distal as well as proximal. And later you said he had inability to get up from squatting position. So that would mean what? Which muscle? Inability to get up from squatting position?
The glutes, gluteal muscles.
Gluteus, okay. Hip extensors.
And the quadriceps.
Okay, quadriceps also. So gluteus, hip extensors, that's involved there. What about iliopsoas? Flexors are not involved?
Yeah. That would be to squat.
Okay. Ileosaurus will be inability to squat, not getting up from squatting position. So you have an involvement of the proximal, the hip muscles, the knee muscles, as well as the ankle joint muscles, isn't it? So, but based on your history, it starts distally and then became proximally within a span of 5 to 6 days. So it's always distal predominant. Okay. So it started from distal and come backwards, and it has happened within 15 days. So that is what you have to say. So based on this, is it a UMN disease or an LMN disease? Is it a neuropathy or it is a
distal predominant?
Distal predominant. So
yes, sir. It could either be either UMN or peripheral neuropathy. Okay. Yes, sir.
And you have simultaneously have to tell that there is no heaviness of the limbs. Patient did not complain of heaviness of the limbs. So it's possibly a LMN disease, not a UMN disease. So you said that there is no heaviness. UMN so disease. Possibly we're dealing with a nerve disease. That's what you can make out. So whenever there's a distal predominant starting, it's either upper motor neuron disease or it's a neuropathy. So only two differentials diagnosis we have. If it is proximal, then we have everything. Everything that would come in, all the proximal diseases that would come in. Okay. Now here, what about, just for discussion sake, why is it not a muscle disease or a neuromuscular junction disease? Based on your history, why is it not a muscle disease?
Muscle disease, it will be present all the time. She will complain of... Like if it's a neuromuscular junction, it is activity dependent usually.
Correct. So neuromuscular junction, you have something called as fatigability, isn't it? Fatigability. It would come only during activity and it would reduce during rest, correct? That's the neuromuscular junction is out. What about the muscle disease? As we discussed, isn't it? Muscle diseases always are proximal predominant. So it will come to the proximal part of the lower limb or the proximal part of the upper limb. And very important thing that is not seen in both muscle disease or a neuromuscular junction disease is the what symptoms this patient has along
sensory
with
weakness.
Sensory. So sensory is never sensory can never be seen with muscle disease. It can rarely be seen with neuromuscular junction, not in myasthenia gravis. Which is the other neuromuscular junction disease that you know of? Any other neuromuscular junction disease?
Eaton-Lambert syndrome.
Eaton-Lambert. So Eaton-Lambert symptoms sometimes can have sensory because it is paraneoplastic and it involves the nerve also. So it's not due to the neuromuscular junction. Lambert-Eaton syndrome is a paraneoplastic condition. So they can have some sensory symptoms because of coexistent neuropathy. Okay. Not because of the neuromuscular junction involvement. So neuromuscular junction is out. Muscle is out. Next site we have is the radicals. Can it be radicals? Can this patient have a lesion in the radicals and that is what it's producing this? What are the features for or against it? Proximal,
but
yes.
Except it radicals, is demyelinating.
Okay. Radicals should be proximal. That's the first and important thing. And based on the disease, if it is a systemic disease like your GB syndrome, it can be bilateral. But most of the diseases which involve the radicals other than GB syndrome are local. They could be unilateral. They can be asymmetrical. Mm-hmm. And whenever the radicals is involved, the most important symptom they come is what will be there if the radicals are involved? What? Mm-hmm. Yeah?
They'll have sharp shooting pain along the distribution of the nerve.
Very, very severe pain. Very, very severe pain. The radicular pain could be there and very, very characteristic pain they'll have. So that would be the feature of a radicular disease. Okay. The last site of element that we have is anterior horn cell. So why can't this be an anterior horn cell disease?
Again, it would be proximal onset disease.
Correct.
Usually
correct.
They give history of fasciculations also, like maybe involuntary
there.
Movements.
Maybe they
are. They are usually, yes, long-standing disease.
Usually long-standing, but can be acute sometimes. What is not seen in anterior horn cell disease? It's a motor unit, no? So again, sensory symptoms. You cannot have sensory. You cannot have sensory symptoms in a anterior horn cell disease. So here the patient would have pure motor, asymmetrical, and very classic florid wasting can be there. And as you said, fasciculations also can be there in that. So here the patient has sensory as well as motor. So the site of lesion is almost certainly it is in the peripheral nerve, which is the other site of lesion where you can get sensory and motor together. Where else can you
that
get
that is the
yeah I couldn't hear you
the roots demyelination of the root
okay that we have discussed
other
any other site where you have sensory and motor loss
okay.
Yeah the spinal cord disease isn't it whenever you have a spinal cord disease okay. So how do you differentiate the sensory problem of a spinal cord disease versus a sensory problem of a neuropathy? What is the pattern you get in spinal cord disease? What is the pattern you get in case of neuropathy?
Like spinal cord disease, they have selective loss of weaknesses, like particular sensations are
okay, lost. There might be particular sensation lost.
Particular sensations.
Okay, and the loss will be about a level, isn't it? You have a straight level you get.
Level.
Very clear level. Below that, the sensations are almost always lost. Whereas, in case of neuropathy, how is the sensory loss? As you described in your patient, what is that pattern called as? Starts from the distal.
Glove and stocking.
And comes. Yes, glove and stocking. What do you mean by that glove and stocking pattern means? It is graded, isn't it? So
like,
below the ankle,
it is graded, yeah.
Yeah, 75% lost. After that, it is 50% loss, 25% loss, something like that. So it's a graded sensory loss that we have. So the glove and stocking or the graded sensory loss is a characteristic feature of a peripheral neuropathy, whereas a sensory level classically is a feature of spinal cord disease. And if there is an acute spinal cord disease, like a transverse myelitis, what other problem they'll have? What else also will get involved?
Urinary incontinence.
Yes, very important. The bladder and bowel disturbances, especially they will should have that as a symptom that would come in. So that if that was there, then your feature would have been more in favor of a spinal cord disease. So based on your history, you have a distal onset of weakness and there is a distal onset of sensory symptoms that we have, correct? As well as there is no history of a upper limb weakness, there's no history of cranial nerve involvement, there is no history of bowel bladder involvement. So based on this history, what are we dealing with?
So peripheral.
Okay, we are dealing with a peripheral, isn't it? Most likely our diagnosis at the end of your history is a peripheral neuropathy. What's the onset? It is an acute onset or a subacute. As you said, it is subacute to acute. So in an acute neuropathy, which is involving the sensory as well as the motor components. That's why we have a diagnosis of a acute sensory motor neuropathy. Now, when we say the nerve, what other function the nerve also has? Any other function the nerve has? Other than sensory
autonomic.
Autonomic, very important. Yes. So in your patient, did you find any history suggestive or what are the histories that you'll ask for a autonomic dysfunction to get it on your history? What are the histories that you can ask? Whether autonomic is involved or not.
They are altered sweating patterns.
Okay, correct.
And then like if it's a
postural hypertension, bowel and bladder incontinence for postural hypertension, diaphoresis.
Okay. So you could have postural giddiness. As you said, patient, when he gets up, he feels giddy. If he complains that, that's an important sign to suggest postural hypotension, correct? As you said, sweating abnormalities. Either there is an excessive sweating or there is a diminished sweating. That could be a feature. Dryness of mouth. Yes, it could be a feature there. Palpitations, very important. Palpitations, patients gets palpitation. That means the heart rate is varying, isn't it? The earliest sign of cardiac autonomic dysfunction is what happens in the heart? Autonomic dysfunction, the vagus effect is lost. So what happens to the heart rate? increases.
Heart rate increases.
So there is a tachycardia. Yes, tachycardia that is there. So they may feel palpitations. They may get these symptoms that could be there. And a very, very important part of autonomic dysfunction is the sexual dysfunction, which history you have to get very carefully. Did you get any history suggestive of that in your patient? In your personal history, have you got any such histories?
No, like he's 78 years old, sir, so I didn't ask.
You think people at that age should not be functional?
Awkward.
Okay, fine. Okay, maybe age-related things could be there, but then you are supposed to ask. So important thing here they get is something called as retrograde ejaculation. That's supposedly the earliest feature. So what history would you get, or what history would you ask to get that symptom? Retrograde ejaculation. What do you mean by retrograde ejaculation? Okay, the ejaculate comes into the bladder, and whenever they pass the urine later, the urine will have semen. So that's the history that you're supposed to get, and that later the patient can have a true erectile dysfunction and all those things. So early features is supposed to be the retrograde ejaculation, which a little younger patient, definitely you should ask for it. Okay. So autonomic involvement, if it is there, does it help us? Does it help us? If this patient has a neuropathy and there is autonomic involvement also. There are not all.
It can tell us the etiology of.
Correct. So what are the etiologies you can get into your discussion when you have an autonomic dysfunction? I couldn't hear you that. I couldn't get clear.
Diabetic neuropathy. Diabetes,
correct. That should be the first cause. Correct. Diabetes neuropathy is the first cause. Again, remember, diabetes, is it an acute neuropathy or it's a chronic? Diabetes,
like,
is
it? It's chronic, but
it is chronic. So remember, when they ask you chronic neuropathy with autonomic dysfunction, please remember it is diabetes as the cause. If I say it's an acute, like our patient has here, it's an acute, correct? Acute neuropathy with autonomic dysfunction. Mm-hmm. What is your example? The example which we have been discussing from long time. That is your?
Yes, sir.
GB syndrome, please remember, acute neuropathy with autonomic dysfunction. One more very close mimic of GB syndrome, where you have florid autonomic signs. Neuropathy, I'm talking about neuropathy. I'm not talking about any other. There are other diseases which can cause the autonomic dysfunction, like your Scheidegger, etc. But then a neuropathy which can have autonomic dysfunction. Any other neuropathy? Okay, what are the other conditions where you can get an acute neuropathy? Other than GB syndrome, what are the other causes of acute neuropathy? Can you tell me some causes of acute neuropathy? Etiologies of an acute neuropathy?
Drug-induced neuropathy.
Drug-induced, okay. Drug-induced, okay. They are generally subacute, but yes, certain... chemotherapeutic agents, correct? Like vincristine, etc., can produce acute neuropathy. So, correct. That is one cause. Okay. Other important thing. Sir. Young
metabolic
female
neuropathy.
Yes.
BM and that's porphyria.
Always remember this. Don't think porphyria is a rare disease. Okay. Porphyria is not a rare disease, though we do not see it off. I mean, we do not think of it often. We end up diagnosing everything, every acute condition as GB syndrome. Many a times porphyria is there, okay? And that urinary colors and all, we don't go to ask for. Especially in females, okay? A female coming with a motor weakness and a paraparesis, very characteristically, like GB syndrome only, porphyria always has to be taught about. And it's a very common thing. And if you do not treat it, how do you treat porphyria? Any idea? How do you treat porphyria?
We give glucose with IV hematin.
Yeah, hematin is may not be available possibly, or hemin may not be available. Glucose. So glucose. And the problem with the porphyria that we have is that it can recur. It can come again and again unless we identify it and possibly prevent the precipitating factors, certain drugs, certain infections, certain dehydration can precipitate it. So we should be preventing that. Okay. So porphyria, always remember acute neuropathy, always remember porphyria as a cause. So here we have our patients. Did you have any autonomic history? No, no. No autonomic history at all in your patient.
No, sir.
Okay. So you have a sensory motor polyneuropathy that is there, which is an acute to subacute in onset. Looks like acute only. So the possible diseases that we thought. So what is the etiology you think? Any other significant history is there in your patient? Just can you go down the slides? I think we discussed most of it. Can you come down? Sensory we have discussed. Yes, you have told here about breathlessness and orthopnea. What do you want? Why did you want to tell that to us? Breathlessness and
orthopnea. The GB syndrome is usually ascending. Yes, sir. Okay. Ascending paralysis.
Correct.
So involvement of the diaphragm would probably cause breathlessness and orthopnea.
Bilateral diaphragmatic involvement can produce orthopnea. Okay, fine. Okay. Next, you said about difficulty in holding neck in upright position. Is it easy to get this history from the patient? Holding the neck. It's a little difficult. Maybe the bystanders can get. Okay, what does it tell you? Yes. What does it tell you if there is? Yes. What did you infer from that? Neck holding. Yes.
Neck holding again, the neck extends our involvement. So like the
specific diseases which cause this broken neck or the head lag. So what are the diseases where you get this broken neck? Can you tell me some 1, 2, 3, 4 common causes of broken neck? The number one has to be the disease which we have already discussed, that is. Which you are discussing, that is GB syndrome. So that should be the first cause. Second disease?
In kids, it's like usually botulism.
Okay, botulism is rare. Okay, second disease which you could see, where the neck weakness, very common. In our part, you would get it in your casualty every day. Every casualty, you'll get one case possibly. Snake bite, isn't it? Snake bite.
Oh, the
neurotoxic.
Yeah, snake bite.
Neurotoxic snake bite, either the cobra or the crate. That's the second cause that you had always importantly. Next is myasthenia gravis. Never forget myasthenia gravis. Myasthenia gravis causes neck weakness. There is a muscle disease called as polymyositis. You heard of polymyositis? It's an inflammatory muscle disease which produces this neck weakness. So these are the important causes whenever the neck weakness is there. You have to consider. Can you repeat the list? Okay, I think there's a little echo, so I could not get it. Okay. So GB syndrome, myasthenia gravis, snake bite, and polymyositis, as well as you said in children, you could have botulism that could be there. These are the conditions where you can have your classical broken neck syndrome. Again, remember, there could be other causes, but they are rarer causes. This is the important thing that you have to remember whenever there is a broken neck. Okay. So next you said is no history of cranial nerve deficits. Okay. You could have neuropathies associated with cranial nerves. Cerebral palsy does not cause broken neck. Cerebral palsy is a UMN disease. So there is spasticity. I think somebody in the chat asked. So cerebral palsy causes spasticity. So it does not cause a weakness there. Okay. Cranial nerves, supposedly we are talking about your GB syndrome. What are the cranial nerves that are commonly involved in GB syndrome? Which cranial nerve will you examine? Yes?
Usually. So 3, 4 and 6.
3, 4, 6, correct. But most important one?
7th
cranial nerve. Don't forget it. Bifacial, that is bilateral element 7th nerve, is pathognomonic. If you have a bilateral element 7th nerve, it is always GB syndrome, almost always. Okay. So as you said, the 3, 4, 6, you have the variant. What's the name of that variant? 3, 4, 6 cranial nerve?
Miller-Fisher variant.
Correct. Then you could have the lower cranial nerves involved, the 9th, 10th, the bulbar variety could be there. And as you said, the neck muscles can get weak. So which cranial nerve? Neck muscles? Extensors of the neck?
The 11th cranial
nerve. 11th cranial nerve. So always remember this. And for some reasons, there is papillary edema in GB syndrome. This is a very unique feature. There is no raised intracranial tension, but still there is papillary edema in GB syndrome. Because remember in CSF, if you do the GB syndrome, you have a lot of protein, isn't it? And this protein goes and clogs those CSF spaces that are there, the small CSF pores which are there, through which the CSF is absorbed. So they get papillary edema also. Okay, here you've written no history of swaying while walking. Now, what is the relevance of that? What do you want to infer from that history, swaying while walking?
To rule out the cerebellar involvement.
Do you want to think of cerebellar or any other? You want to rule out ataxia, correct? So what ataxia? In a neuropathy, what sort of ataxia you can get? You get sensory ataxia, isn't it? Posterior column that is getting
sensory ataxia.
So how do you differentiate this sensory ataxia versus cerebellar ataxia?
Based
on history? The sensory ataxia always will worsen during nights as the day progresses, or at the night, na, when the visual input is much less, that is when the sensory ataxia will worsen. Whereas the cerebellar ataxia will be there all throughout the day or night. Sensory ataxia occurs more when they cross narrow passages, and when they close their eyes for any activity, when they close their eyes, the sensory ataxia worsens. And that is the classical sign that is described. That is your wash basin sign. When they close their eyes to wash their face, they become ataxic. And the same test that we use for clinical examination called as the Romberg sign, isn't it? Romberg sign. That is where you can do that. So those signs can be the ones which help us to say whether the posterior column sensations or the vibration joint position is involved or not. Okay. Proceed. What's there in the next slide? Okay, stiffness, you already mentioned about stiffness. That would basically to rule out the upper motor neuron disease. What is this flexor spasms? What is this flexor spasms here told? Hello.
Hello. Yeah. Yes.
Flexor spasm. What is this? What is the relevance of asking the flexor spasms? What disease you get that in? Okay. It's generally seen in a progressive spinal cord disease when the paraplegia from extension goes into paraplegia and flexion, when you have the progressive involvement of the extrapyramidal fibers. So that's a very specific thing for your spinal cord. Okay. And again, it does not happen acutely. It happens on a long standing, a chronic paraplegia, especially a spinal cord disease, you should ask for the flexor spasm. Okay. No history of bladder and bowel incontinence. That's basically to rule out a spinal cord disease. No history of involuntary movements in the thighs and gluteal muscles. What is that? Fasciculations can be anywhere. Okay. Not thighs and gluteal muscles. Okay. Those are the main muscles you're thinking of. Okay. What do you mean by fasciculation? Can you tell me what is a fasciculation? What is a fasciculation?
Like those are involuntary movements. Yes. Involuntary movement in the usually seen in big muscles or proximal muscle due to involvement of anterior horn cell. Like these are potentials from the anterior horn cells.
Okay, so
which can be seen with the naked eye.
It can be seen with the naked eye, correct? So is it an involuntary movement? Is there a movement actually? Is it like any other involuntary movement?
Like it's a twitch.
It's a twitch.
It's okay. A twitch. Or a
twitch means a contraction, na? Is there actually a movement in fasciculation? Again, remember fascicle, it's not the total muscle which is stimulating, isn't it? It's a muscle fascicle, a single fascicle that is there. So very importantly, this does not move the joint. That's what you have to remember. There is no movement of the joint. The movement is within the muscle, okay? So you can, they may say like some frogs are jumping on within the muscles. That's the history they say. In Kannada, they say kappe, like a frog jumping. It does not cross the joint. That is very important. So it's a quivering movements under the skin. Very important. This is not an involuntary movement because it does not move the joint. So fasciculations is a very characteristic feature of you, as you very classically told in case of anterior horn cell disease. Anterior horn cell disease. Now, supposedly, what are the other causes, common causes, one or two causes of fasciculations? Can you tell me other than anterior horn cell disease? Any other conditions you can get fasciculations? Yes? There is some lag in your voice. I can't hear it.
Okay. Hello.
Yeah, I can hear you. Other than any poisons, very common poison that we see, very good fasciculations. Commonest poison that you see in your
OP poisoning.
Very, very important. So OP poisoning, please remember, OP poisoning is one important condition, the nicotinic effect, you get florid fasciculations. Okay. Remember thyrotoxicosis. Thyrotoxicosis, very important endocrine disease where you can get fasciculations. So you can get it in OP poisoning. Also, you treat OP poisoning with what? What is the treatment of OP poisoning? What's the drug that we use? Atropine. Okay, so again, atropine also produces fasciculation. So remember, not PAM, atropine produces fasciculations and OP poisoning produces fasciculations. You get fasciculations in case of, again, polio, though it's an anterior horn cell disease, fasciculations are seen in a sequelae of polio. There is a sequelae of polio which occurs after 10 to 15 years of polio. Are you aware of it? In pediatrics, they would have shown you some cases of polio. After 15 years of polio, they would get a syndrome called as post-polio.
Sorry, sir.
No problem. Himanshu, you're there? Okay, so there's a condition called as
post-polio. I can't see the screens.
That's okay. They'll share it by that time. I think, who was sharing the screen? Okay, it's come. Okay. So there's a condition called as post-polio progressive muscular atrophy, PPMA, post-polio progressive muscular atrophy. There is, we get a lot of fasciculations. Okay. So you should know that fasciculations. Can fasciculations be benign? Can it be physiological? Can you get fasciculations physiological? Whenever the question is fasciculations, is when the question starts with can, answer should generally be yes. Okay.
Yeah.
You do get fasciculations benign, but they're not persistent. So very importantly, you have to remember fasciculations are only important if the muscle has been wasted. So please remember that fasciculations are important when the muscle is wasted. Otherwise, you don't give importance to the fasciculations. So fasciculations are important once the muscle is wasted. Yes, you can get fasciculations with the calcium, magnesium deficiencies, etc. Also, you can get that. How can you stimulate fasciculations? You want to get a fasciculation. Supposedly, you have a motor neuron disease patient. You want to get fasciculations? You want to demonstrate. The examiner asks you, demonstrate fasciculations.
No, I don't know, sir.
Okay. You have to just make sure that the ionized calcium becomes less. So you can induce alkalosis in the patient. How do you induce alkalosis? Any common physiological way
to induce alkalosis? Asking to breathe rapidly.
So hyperventilation. So that's a simple thing that can be done.
Yes, sir.
So where all the muscles will go into contraction, twitching starts. So that can be done. Sometimes it can be appearing on your cold. If you apply something cold, it might, but hyperventilation is one easy way where you can demonstrate fasciculations. Yes. Can we go to the next slide? Okay. I think this is okay. This were all the negative histories that you wanted to tell me regarding GB syndrome. Okay, fine. Yes, next. Yeah, you can continue from here, Himanshu.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. History of past illness. History of an episode exactly like the current history about 6 months back, preceded by fever and coryza complaints. Symptoms lasted for about 2 weeks and resolved completely following treatment in a tertiary care setup. Symptoms were completely absent post this episode. He was given a tablet for nerve strength for 2 months.
Okay, so a patient comes with this, like as you described, a weakness, episodic weaknesses. So what are the differential diagnoses that you have in your mind when there is episodes coming again and again?
Like relapsing remitting multiple sclerosis.
Okay, multiple sclerosis, correct. Again, please remember, just yes, before you go further, MS is a disease, affects the upper motor neuron. Okay, MS is a disease which goes to UMN disease, it is. Okay, so it can involve anyway from the brain to the spinal cord. It cannot involve the peripheral nerve. So please remember, MS is a disease which involves the upper motor neuron. It is not the lower motor neuron. Okay, but yes, it can produce again and again, correct? Any other diseases?
Yes, sir. It could be like hypo or hyperkalemic periodic.
Very important. Hypo and hyperkalemic. Again, a very, very common disease that we see. Okay. How does hypokalemia get precipitated? Why should they develop this episodic again and again?
It's related to insulin, maybe.
Okay, it's related to insulin, correct?
Because insulin.
Correct?
Yeah, insulin. Okay, so meals containing high glucose.
Carbohydrate, correct. So whenever they take a feast, when they go for a feast or something and have a lot of sugar or something like that, it precipitates and they would come with weakness. And generally, what do? If they become weak, generally, if supposedly in their villages or somewhere they feel weak, what do? They would take some. Yeah, somebody has mentioned, yes. Coconut water generally, isn't it? So sugar would worsen it. So they wouldn't take sugar. They would take tender coconut water, isn't it? Quite rampantly, we use tender coconut water. People drink a lot of tender coconut water. So the potassium might get corrected. So this periodic paralysis is a very common disease. Okay. What else can come with this weakness? Again and again weakness. Any other disease?
Can it be myasthenia gravis?
Can be myasthenia. Very good. Myasthenia gravis can come. Yes. Can Guillain-Barré syndrome or your AIDP keep coming again and again?
CIDP.
Okay. CIDP is where it continuously progresses. We have a variety called as relapsing GB. That can come again and again. Okay. So remember, myasthenia gravis, periodic paralysis, acute intermittent porphyrias, GB syndrome, all these things can be repeated episodes. As you already said about MS, there could be other diseases which can keep periodically coming. There are rare diseases like you have your enzymopathies, you know, various enzyme deficiencies which are there, the muscle enzymes, etc. They can also produce periodic weaknesses, but they are little rarer. So remember myasthenia gravis, and your very important is potassium. Always check potassium in a patient who comes with weakness, because it can be treated and it can be corrected. Yes. Can you go to the next slide? Yes. So what is relevant in this patient based on? He was on metformin and now he's on insulin. So is it relevant in a patient like this? 14 years of diabetes. So is it important for us?
So it's a predictor of diabetic neuropathy.
Okay, so diabetic.
And he's on metformin, so correct. That can cause, yes,
correct.
That can cause B12 deficiency, correct. And then correct. He can come with subacute cord degeneration.
B12 deficiency produces more of neuropathy first, then the cord. Cord is very rare to produce that. Okay, so metformin is there,
yes,
and
sir.
He has been started on insulin. So somebody has been started on insulin, can it produce some problems like this? Insulin. Does insulin produce a neuropathy? When I said when the question is scanned, the answer has to be.
Can it cause?
Answer has to be yes. No?
Yes.
Insulin neuropathies are also there. So
yes.
Supposedly somebody has been started on insulin. You can produce insulin neuritis. Painful neuropathies can be seen with insulin. Okay. So here you have a patient who is a chronic diabetic patient. So he's been on drugs. So diabetic neuropathy can also be seen. Which other neuropathy is common in diabetics? Other than diabetic neuropathy, which is the other neuropathy which is very common in diabetic patients? We are discussing about what neuropathy?
I know.
Which neuropathy are we discussing from?
Demyelinating.
Demyelinating, isn't it? So what is that demyelinating neuropathy in diabetics? It is not acute. It is not acute. So it has to be chronic, CIDP. Chronic. Have you heard of this word CIDP? Chronic inflammatory demyelinating polyneuropathy. Yes. Very, very common in diabetics. Very, very common diabetics. Okay. GB syndrome, no, not GB syndrome. GB syndrome can occur in anywhere. CIDP is very common in diabetics. Though it's not related to diabetes, but you find a lot of diabetic patients developing CIDP. So that is what you have to remember. Yes. Proceed. Next slide. Okay. Hypertension. Is it relevant to our case?
Now I can see it. Yeah. History of hypertension. Should I present it, sir?
Yeah, you can just tell me the relevance. I think all of us can see it. No problem. Hypertension in this patient.
Okay.
What's your relevance? Is it relevant or not?
Had it been a unilateral weakness?
No.
Maybe. But bilateral,
we are suspecting a GB syndrome. We are suspecting other causes of paraplegia, which we discussed, isn't it? Acute onset.
Okay. It could be a anterior spinal artery stroke, hemorrhagic stroke.
That's rare. Supposedly I say this hypokalemia. Can hypertension and hypokalemia, can you relate?
Yes. The drugs can precipitate hypokalemia.
Antihypertensive.
The
hypokalemia. Diuretics, isn't it? Diuretics. Diuretics produce hypokalemia, which is commonly prescribed, and that can produce severe hypokalemia and the patient can have weakness. As you said, ACE inhibitors and ARBs, they produce hyperkalemia, but that hyperkalemia is not to the level where they can produce the weakness. Supposedly a patient has been, after this neuropathy, diagnosed to have hypertension. What is your relevance of that? The neuropathy has set in, then the hypertension has come in. It would indicate what? It indicates, again, autonomic dysfunction. So if a new onset of hypertension, if you want to think of, it always would mean a feature of autonomic dysfunction. Yes. Yeah.
Could it be a vasculitic neuropathy?
Could be vasculitic neuropathy. But again, remember, all vasculitis except for Takayasu's, all the rest vasculitis are seen in younger patients. So at this age, it's a little difficult to get the vasculitis, 75 plus. I'm not saying it's rare, but then it can happen. But young patient, definitely, if hypertension is there and neuropathy is there, you should consider vasculitis like polyarteritis nodosa, correct? Yeah. You can proceed to the next slide. Yes, he's on metformin, insulin, and ramipril. Okay, fine. Okay. What's the relevance of this social and personal history?
Okay. Vegetarian diet for B12 deficiency, then alcohol induced vitamin deficiencies, if at all he was alcoholic.
No alcohol, but alcohol induced, correct? Very good. Yes.
Then history of loss of weight could be a ixol in the spinal cord.
Why do you want to get a spinal? We are talking about nerve, no? Weight loss and nerve. So okay. It means a malignancy, isn't it? Can a malignancy cause neuropathy?
By paraneoplastic.
Paraneoplastic. Again, it can be acute. Paraneoplastic neuropathies can be there. Okay, fine. Yes. We'll proceed to the next slide. Family history, okay. So in the neuropathy, younger patients, if supposedly it's a young patient in neuropathy, we should think of family history very strongly, but at this age, maybe it's not relevant. Okay. Next slide. Okay. So do you want to modify it a little or you want to tell the same one?
Proximal more than distal.
Where is it proximal more than distal? Your history is still distal onset, na? Proximal, maybe okay. An examination we might find. Okay. So here you have an elderly male who has an acute onset or a subacute or acute onset of paraplegia, isn't it? Paraplegia.
Yes, sir.
And sensory complaints in the distal part of the lower limbs. So what do you think is your diagnosis? Is your final diagnosis what you have discussed as acute inflammatory demyelinating polyneuropathy? Is it correct or you want to reframe that word?
It's
acute, correct?
But demyelinating
demyelinating.
It's peripheral neuropathy.
Okay. Acute polyneuropathy. So that's enough. You don't have to go on to tell very, 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 very specific like this. Okay. So here we have a patient who has an acute onset of low limb weakness and sensory symptoms that is there. So it is a possibility of an acute onset of polyneuropathy. So common question they ask you in the exam, what are the causes of acute paraplegia? So acute paraplegia, what are the causes?
It could be spastic or...
It could be flaccid. Okay, good. Can you tell me the flaccid ones? You can. LMN, you can tell.
Yes, sir. LMN, it could be, it could involve the cord. So it
LMN
could be.
LMN in the cord. Okay, fine.
The anterior horn cell.
Okay.
Like transverse myelitis.
Transverse myelitis is a UMN disease. It's not an LMN disease.
Okay.
LMN, you start from the nerve, muscle, neuromuscular junction.
Okay. So. Drug-induced neuropathies.
Etiology, it's okay. You tell me the diseases. Acute polyneuropathy, that's the first one. Next, acute muscle disease.
Polymyositis.
Okay, polymyositis. More important, what we discussed just now. Muscle. Periodic paralysis. Next, you have the neuromuscular junction, as you told me.
Myasthenia.
So these are the three important diseases that you have to remember. So acute polyneuropathy, acute myasthenia gravis, and acute periodic paralysis, as you discussed. So these are the three important causes. And the closest mimic for GB syndrome, which we discussed that time, which is acute porphyria. Never forget porphyria. Always remember porphyria. Okay. Coming on to the upper motor neuron diseases which produce paraplegia.
Transverse myelitis.
Transverse myelitis. Very good. So transverse myelitis. Okay. One more cause. Only lower limb weakness.
ACS stroke.
What ACS stroke? Anything like, more qualifying? Any more qualification you want to do for the ACA?
If it's unpaired, it causes bilateral.
Very important. Unpaired. Because bilateral, no? Paraplegia, when I tell you it is bilateral, correct? So
yes,
it has to be an unpaired ACA stroke. Okay. So these are the important causes which produce paraplegia whenever a patient comes with. So these are the differential diagnoses that you'll have to think of. We can have rarer possibilities. I think in the chat they're mentioning about superior sagittal sinus thrombosis can occur and can produce acute paraplegias. Acute hydrocephalus. Okay. They will have some other features also associated, but can produce. I'm not saying it can't, it can produce. Okay. But remember about the lower motor ones and the upper motor ones. Okay. So do you think this patient has GB syndrome? Before we go on to examination, do you think this patient has GB syndrome?
Yes.
Why? What are the features which are telling you it is GB syndrome? What are the features which are not fitting GB syndrome in your patient?
Okay, so firstly, it's acute onset. The illness is less than 4 weeks. There is a classic proximal progression.
Correct.
And both sensory and motor is involved.
Correct. So and, that is a feature in favor of GB syndrome for you? Sensory and motor involvement?
GB
syndrome like classically is? Classical GB syndrome is motor, isn't it?
Amania.
It's a motor weakness. Sensory is rare in GB syndrome. I'm not saying it's not there, but the predominant symptoms that are there in case of GB syndrome is always motor. They may complain of some tingling numbness, but sensory is not involved in case of GB syndrome. For all practical purposes, you have a rare varieties, very, very rare varieties where sensory is involved. But please remember, GB syndrome cannot be used as a diagnosis if you have sensory, subjective or objective sensory involvement in your patient. GB syndrome is out. So please remember this, very important. GB syndrome is purely motor. So here your patient has a very significant sensory symptoms. We'll have to look at in the examination. If he has no sensory involvement in the examination, then it's okay. Maybe we can still consider GB syndrome. Otherwise, we have to think of a second possibility. Okay?
Yes.
So GB syndrome is not there. Acute polyneuropathy, that's what you can consider. Possibly inflammatory, or it could be any toxin mediated, or it could be a porphyria. Or in a patient who has already has a chronic neuropathy due to diabetes, might be an acute worsening due to certain symptoms. Okay.
Sir, when we use the term AIDP, does it always mean it's GBS?
AIDP, what's the full form of AIDP?
Acute inflammatory
demyelinating
polyneuropathy.
Okay, remember the P stands for radiculoneuropathy. Okay, polyradiculoneuropathy.
Okay.
AIDP. It's not a neuropathy. There we already we qualify it as polyradiculo. Polyradiculo. So it's a proximal. When we say AIDP, it means GB syndrome only.
Okay,
sir. It means GB syndrome only. GB syndrome is the persons who have identified it. They are the ones who are the ones. How many of them are there who identify GB syndrome? Any idea? Is it only Guillain and Barre or somebody else was there? Okay, it was identified by somebody called as Landry first. It was first called as Landry's palsy. Not Laundry, huh? Landry. Landry. Landry, Guillain-Barre. There was one more person. Four of them together made it. Okay. So two names have already gone. So Guillain-Barre is still remaining, but that also would eventually go. The disease possibly is AIDP only. So it's the pathology of the disease that we are describing it as in that. Okay. Any other doubts you have at this time? Any other clarifications you want?
No, sir.
Okay, then we can proceed.
Okay, examination findings. General physical examination. Patient was examined on day one of admission. He was lying down comfortably on his bed. He was conscious, cooperative, well-oriented to time, place, and person. Moderately built and poorly nourished with a body mass index of 17.9.
Okay.
Vitals, pulse of 104 beats per minute, regular rhythm, high volume, no special character, arterial wall not thickened, peripheral pulses are felt with normal intensity bilaterally, no radioradial or radiofemoral delay. Blood pressure of 140 bar 64 millimeter mercury, right arm supine position, respiratory rate of 18 cycles per minute, predominantly abdominal thoracic, pattern and depth is normal, there is no use of accessory muscles for respiration. Patient was afebrile, temporal temperature of I can't read it.
37 point. Okay. So what is your relevance now of this, of so much what you have made? Anything significant you feel?
Yeah. 104 is tachycardia. So
it's a resting tachycardia. So resting tachycardia is a very subtle sign of autonomic dysfunction. Okay. If you're not able to explain the tachycardia because of anything else, temperature is not there, patient is not anxious, but the tachycardia is there, that means it could be a sign of autonomic dysfunction. Yes. Any other thing abnormal?
Volume is high.
Volume is high. Yes. As well as your blood pressure is showing a wide pulse pressure, isn't it? 140, 64. It's almost 80. So what is the cause for that, you think? What is the cause for that? White pulse pressure, high volume.
Could it be not related to the illness? Concurrent anemia?
Anemia, that's a very important thing. So you say he is a vegetarian and he is possibly could have anemia, and the anemia could be severe, which could produce the tachycardia, it could produce the white pulse pressure. Okay. Or else, the other causes of white pulse pressure, either cardiac or non-cardiac, we'll have to think of. Okay.
Yes.
Proceed.
Head to toe examination. Pallor noted in lower palpebral conjunctiva, oral mucosa, and nail bed. Palmar creases look normal. No icterus, clubbing, cyanosis, generalized lymphoid.
What would you specifically look in the palmar creases? Anything?
The discoloration of the creases with respect to the surrounding palm.
Would suggest?
Severe pallor less than 8 hemoglobin.
Okay, that would be for severe anemia. In B12, anything specific you would look for?
The palmar crease will be hyperpigmented.
Hyperpigmented. So that's very important. So if that was there, then you would have possibly thought of. Yes, correct. Proceed.
No icterus, clubbing, cyanosis, generalized lymphadenopathy or pedal edema. No signs of nutrition deficiency. No neurocutaneous markers. No thickening of peripheral nerves.
This is very important. Thickening of peripheral nerves. So what are the peripheral nerves which you normally palpate?
In the arm, it is this ulnar nerve.
Correct.
Then the posterior auricular nerve. Then the peroneal nerve.
Auricular or anything better word?
The auricular temporal.
The greater auricular nerve.
Greater auricular.
Where do you palpate for this greater auricular nerve? You just have to tell me where do you palpate for the greater auricular nerve? What's the anatomical? This is a very common thing they ask you in the exam. So where is this greater auricular nerve located?
It's on the sternocleidomastoid.
Correct. It's on the sternocleidomastoid. So it's nowhere close to the ear. It's somewhere between the upper third and the lower two third of the sternocleidomastoid. It runs across the sternocleidomastoid. So that's where you can see that. Yes. Okay. What are the other nerves?
In the lower limb.
Lower limb, correct?
Against the fibular neck, the peroneal nerve.
So you can see the common peroneal nerve or the posterior tibial nerve can be palpated there. Anything on the face, you can get the
face.
Around the eyes.
Supratrochlear.
Commonly seen with leprosy. Okay. What are the conditions where you can get this nerve thickening? So if the nerves are thickened, what are the diseases that come into your mind?
Most common would be leprosy.
Correct.
Then infiltration disorder like sarcoid and amyloid.
Mm-hmm.
The Charcot-Marie. Yes,
very important. Hereditary neuropathies. Inherited neuropathies, you have two important ones. One is a Charcot-Marie tooth. One more, you have something called as a Dejerine-Sottas. So these are two common hereditary neuropathies. Anything more commoner? You said leprosy is the commonest.
Nerves. Okay. Is it von Recklinghausen?
Yeah, neurofibromatosis. Neurofibromatosis, you can get it. But whenever we discuss neuropathies, please remember, leprosy is the first thing. Second one is CIDP. CIDP is a very important disease which produces nerve thickening. Always remember this. If you find nerve thickening in a patient and there are no cutaneous manifestations of leprosy and there is no hereditary, etc., you should consider CIDP. Okay, CIDP nerve thickening is a very important finding. So leprosy, CIDP, Charcot-Marie tooth, Dejerine-Sottas, as you said, amyloid, neurofibromatosis, sometimes with reference disease. So these are the conditions where you can get nerve thickening. So you should be able to palpate the nerves as well as you should be able to know the causes of nerve thickening. Please remember CIDP as a very important cause. Okay. Leprosy and CIDP. Okay. What are the other general examination findings you look for in a patient with neuropathy in general, other than nerve thickening?
Signs of atherosclerosis, head to toe signs.
Is it relevant for neuropathy?
Neuropathy, no.
No. Of the etiologies, like you said, nutritional deficiency. You should carefully look for that, as you already mentioned it here, no signs of it. So specifically, we'll have to look for B12. We'll have to look for all those signs very clearly. Yes, any other things on general examination? We'll be looking for whether there is a hypopigmentation or hyperpigmentation of any signs of leprosy, hypopigmented macules if you find, or a hyperpigmented lesions. So both of them have relevance for neuropathy. So you'll have to look for that. And as general examination, you'll have to look for the BP, sitting BP or standing BP to look for postural hypertension. That's a very important thing that you have to make sure that you have done. Okay, proceed.
CNS examination, higher mental function. He had a mini mental scale.
Preferably use the word nervous system examination.
Okay.
It's not central alone, na? You're looking for everything, isn't it? And your case is basically a peripheral. So it's preferable to use nervous system. There's no harm. It's just the little idiosyncrasies of people. Okay. So it's nervous system is always better. Okay.
Higher mental function, like mini mental scale of 30.
Okay. Conscious quality. Please remember your higher mental functions always when it starts, you always use that last word, the last line, what you've written. You have to, you tell that first. That is, patient is a right-handed individual. Okay. Educated up to this much. So this thing you have to start your higher mental functions based on the right-handed individual or left-handed individual, and he is educated up till here. Then you start your other things. Always tell that in the right in the beginning of your examination. Why do we have to discuss about handedness?
In this patient or in general?
General neurology. In neurology, handedness, importance of handedness.
It says the dominance of the hemisphere.
Correct.
And if it is the hand that he uses for majority of activities, then like the management will have to concentrate more on.
Okay, that's a very important thing. So you have to know the handedness basically because you have to plan the rehabilitation. If the dominant hand is involved, definitely you will have to rehabilitate them aggressively so that the deficit that remains is very minimal. Okay. There are certain diseases which are common in patients who have the left dominant, normally the left dominant cortex, isn't it? If they are right dominant cortex, if it is there, there are certain diseases which could be prominent in them. Can you know, are you aware of any diseases?
Like which are they are common? Prone to stuttering and stammer. And Huntington's chorea is also.
Huntington's chorea is seen in patients who have right dominant cortex. Okay. So high mental functions is normal. Supposedly you had a vitamin B12 deficiency. Anything would have affected in the high mental functions?
I don't know.
A chronic deficiency, na, would have resulted in dementias, isn't it? One of the causes of dementias is your vitamin deficiency, especially vitamin B12 deficiency can produce dementia. So it could have affected, though it's not there in your patient. Okay. Proceed.
Okay.
All your cranial nerves are normal?
Normal, yes, sir.
Any change you want to do it in your case sheet? Any change which you want to written it very beautifully? Very rarely do you find such good case sheets, especially typed. Any change that you must do as a rule?
As a rule, okay. I put ulta. I did not.
Unknowingly, your both sides were equal, na? Same, na? No abnormalities, na? In the cranial nerves.
No, sir. Yes.
You should have always the second column is right. Okay. Don't make these simple mistakes. It's very difficult in your neuro case sheet. It goes on for pages together, isn't it? So always make sure that even if the left side is abnormal, write it in the third column. Never write it in the second column. So you have to write it. That's by tradition, just by tradition. Okay. Fine. Proceed. So all your cranial nerves are normal. We have discussed cranial nerves can get involved in various neuropathies. What are the cranial nerves that can get involved in a diabetic patients? What are the common cranial nerves that could get involved in diabetic patients?
Facial itself.
Facial can get involved, correct? More importantly, third nerve. Very importantly, you have a disease. Do you know about a named disease where the third nerve, painful ophthalmoplegia, they develop?
Painful
ophthalmoplegia in a diabetic, which can reverse completely after treatment. Like Bell's palsy for seventh nerve, which is the disease for third nerve.
I don't know.
Heard of Tolosa-Hunt syndrome?
Yeah, like that 3, 4, and 6.
Yeah. Superior orbital fissure there. So it's something like the Bell's palsy for 7th nerve. Very, very common in diabetic patients, okay, which completely recovers. Painful ophthalmoplegia that recovers. And fundus, you'll have a lot of changes in diabetes. So fundus has to be examined. Okay, proceed.
Yeah, motor system examination, attitude of the limb, upper limbs, shoulder adducted, neutral flexion rotation, elbow extended, wrist flexed, finger flexed, lower limb hips adducted, neutral flexion rotation, knees extended, ankle plantar flexed.
Okay.
Bulk of the muscles, impression. Yes, sir.
Equal. So you said no atrophy. So if there is atrophy, what are the causes of small muscles atrophy in the hand? Tell us some causes of atrophy.
Muscle atrophy in the hand could be a long-standing motor neuron disease. Okay. It could be
Again, whenever they ask you causes in neurology, na, you can start from one end of the nervous system and you can come down so that you can easily go. So start from the distal most part. So you have the muscle, isn't it? So what are the muscle diseases? Distal muscle diseases. Can you name one distal muscle disease?
Distal muscle. I know.
You have wasting of the hand. Inherited disease. Myotonic dystrophy. Heard of myotonic dystrophy?
Yeah, but I thought it's predominant proximal.
It is predominant proximal, but then you can have distal muscle wasting also. You have certain distal myopathies also where you can have. So after the muscle, the next is the neuromuscular junction. Again, remember neuromuscular junction does not have wasting. Then coming on to the neuropathies. Next is the nerve, isn't it? So name some neuropathies where the small muscles of the hands are wasted. Common one.
Median nerve, carpal tunnel syndrome.
Okay, carpal tunnel syndrome. Good. Any other hand, clawing of hand you get?
Leprosy.
Leprosy, very common. Leprosy can be there. So you finish the nerve. After that, you're going to the radicals. So what are the diseases which affect the radicals? Your brachial plexus, where you can have wasting.
That chronic CAT1 involvement.
What diseases which you would have learned?
Cervical rib, pancreas tumor.
Pancreas tumor. Simple, isn't it? So where the plexus get involved. So you could have wasting of the hands. So from there, we finish the radicals. Now we are entering the spinal cord and we reach the anterior horn cell. So the disease is?
The Logerich's disease.
Yeah, Logerich's disease. Again, try to avoid names, okay? Because you might be, you're pronouncing it absolutely proper. Or quite almost 90% of them, of us, would generally pronounce all these names differently. So half of us wouldn't understand what you're saying. Okay. So it's better to say it as amyotrophic lateral sclerosis or a motor neuron disease. Okay. So the anterior horn cell is over. After that, what's there behind it? The anterior horn cell can get compressed when there is enlargement of the
syrinx.
Very good. The central canal gets expanding forward. Anterior horn cell can get compressed. So you get wasting of the muscles. So you have this 5 to 10 causes, you have got it. So you get the full marks. So whenever you say in an order, na, generally it is believed somebody who tells it in order, that means they know very, very clearly. Only then can you tell this order. So anytime when you start in an order, generally it gives an impression that you have studied it well. So anything for any system also, always tell it in an order. Okay. So syringomyelia, anterior horn cell disease like amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, then the radicals involvement, as you said, in case of cervical rib, pancreas tumor. And then we said about the neuropathies, which could be there due to leprosy, median nerve injury, or some other neuropathies in the upper limb. Then you had the muscle diseases, the distal myopathies are there, the Duchenne's is there, myotonic dystrophy is there. So all these conditions can produce wasting of the muscles. Also remember, you could have diseases which affect the arthritis, chronic arthritis, which affect the hand, like which is the disease? Arthritis of the hand.
Rheumatoid arthritis.
So there is a wasting in such conditions also. There could be wasting generalized. Okay, wasting could be generalized all over the body, but here we are discussing about wasting of small muscles of the hand. Yes. So atrophy is not there. So these are the diseases are little less likely. If I'm talking about a neuropathy and there is wasting, so what is your relevance? A patient has a neuropathy and there is wasting.
It means the nerve growth factors are not reaching the muscle. So it's probably an LMN lesion, long-standing LMN lesion.
LMN nerve is always LMN, correct? It could be long-standing, correct? Now, based on the pathology, pathologically, the neuropathies are due to what is the pathology? What is happening there in the nerve? Either there is
demyelination
or there is
compression.
Compression. What's the other pathology? One is demyelination. Second one is
transection.
Axonal, isn't it? Where the axon is getting degenerated per se. So neuropathies are of two types. You see, when you have the nerve, you know the how is the structure of the nerve? You have the nerve body, then you have the axon, and on that you have the myelin, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Did you get it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
When there is demyelination, there is problem with the demyelination, like you have your GB syndrome. Then you have problems directly in the axonal damage, which commonly occurs in diabetic patients. Diabetic patients, all the neuropathies are axonal, or there are toxins, various diseases where the axon itself is damaged. Now, always remember the difference between an axonal neuropathy versus a demyelinating neuropathy. One of the differences we have already discussed that time, demyelinating neuropathies are always proximal in onset, because along with the nerve, the radicals also get demyelinated. Whereas axonal is always distal, starts from the distal and comes forward, like what is happening in your patient, starts from the distal and comes forward. The second important feature you have to remember is axonal neuropathies always have significant wasting. So it is, if you find wasting in a patient with neuropathy, it is most often that it is axonal neuropathy. And they have a very, very bad prognosis compared to demyelination. The axonal neuropathies have bad prognosis. So that is what you have to remember. So what are the differences between demyelination and axonal? Can you repeat?
Yes, sir. Axonal is distal onset. Demyelinating is proximal onset. Axonal has significant wasting and it has poor prognosis.
Okay. The other very important difference that you have to do is when you examine the reflexes, when you examine your deep tendon reflexes, what happens in GB syndrome, your AIDP? What has a rule? As a rule, you should have?
A reflexia.
Yeah, what a reflexia?
Like
one more word.
Asymmetric or
generalized. All reflexes should be gone. So demyelinating neuropathies, you have generalized areflexia. So biceps, triceps, supinator, knee, ankle jerk, everything is gone. That is in demyelination. Whereas in case of axonal neuropathy, you will only have distal areflexia. That means the ankle might be gone, supinator may be gone, but the triceps, biceps, knee jerk is well preserved. So these are the differences that you can make out based on your history and examination, whether the pathology is demyelinating or axonal. So is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, we'll proceed. Next slide. I think we are already reached 7:30. Do we have time to continue, or anybody in the host is there?
Yes, sir. We can continue, sir.
Okay. So the tone is normal, you have told. Okay, tone is normal. Can you define tone for me?
The resistance offered by the muscle on passive motion of the joint.
Okay, so resistance offered by the muscle on passive movement of the joint. That's the clinical definition. What's the physiological definition?
The gamma efferent activity of the muscle spindle.
Something simpler. State of? Tone is defined as a state of partial contraction of the muscle at rest.
Okay.
So at rest itself, there is a state of contraction that is due to your gamma efferents. Agreed. So state of partial contraction of the muscle at rest, that is demonstrated by the resistance offered by the muscle to passive movement across the joint. So that's a definition that you have for tone. So supposedly I ask you to demonstrate tone of the right-sided biceps. In the exam, they'll ask you, how do you demonstrate tone of the right biceps? Can you describe?
Yes, sir. Like, I tell the patient that you're going to flex the elbow of the right side and ask him to completely relax the muscle.
Okay.
Then support with your left hand the elbow and then flex the biceps with the right hand first slowly and then like increase the velocity of flexion subsequently.
Okay. So you're going to feel the biceps when you're flexing. Correct?
No, that is the power, I think.
As we discussed, what is it? The muscle should be at rest, isn't it?
Rest, yeah.
So when will you feel the biceps? When is the biceps at rest? In which movement? Flexion or extension? Flexion or extension? Biceps at rest.
At rest is in extension.
So very important. When they ask you to demonstrate biceps, agreed, it flexion is where it's seen, but you have to make sure that you feel for the tone only during extension. Clear? So
yes,
you ask the patient to flex it on his own, or you can get it to flexion and then put your hand on the biceps and then do the extension. So you're feeling the muscle tone when the muscle is at rest.
Yes.
So please remember all these small things you have to remember. Triceps, if I'm asking you to check which movement, triceps.
Elbow extension, but check the tone on elbow flexion.
Yes. So when you're flexing, your hand should be behind here, correct? And when you're extending, the hand should be in front. That is how you check for the tone. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
So this is very important. You have to be. Same thing in the leg also when you're checking for the tone. Always feel the muscle when it is in rest, not during action. Okay? Yes. We'll proceed. So for triceps, triceps is when you're doing flexion. Triceps action is extension. So that time it's contracting. So when you flex, you feel the triceps. Yeah. Proceed.
Yes, sir.
Power. Yes.
Power. Yeah. So the power at shoulder joint, all the movements are normal, but at elbow joint, both flexion and extension is 4+. And at wrist joint also, it is 4+. Hand grip is normal.
Okay, so again, this 4+ and 5+. Again, some of the examiners are a little touchy about it. What do you mean by this 5+? Tell me.
Like,
what's the maximum power you can have?
5.
Then what is this 5+? Your and your next batchmate's power put together? It cannot be, no? It cannot be 5+. 4+ is at least acceptable somewhere, possibly. 5+ cannot be. Okay.
Yes.
The grading is up to 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, isn't it? Or 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. What is this grading?
It's modified research council grading.
Correct. Tell me about the grading.
0 is no movement, 1 is a flicker, 2 is with gravity eliminated, 3 is against gravity, 4 is with minimal resistance, and 5 is max.
Okay. Is there 4+ and all in that grading?
Hello.
Is there 4+ in that grading?
No, in that it's not there. So like when there is an upper limb and lower limb involvement, if you have to compare the power of two sides, we put plus and minus.
Really? That is not why this plus and minus came into. Plus is more than 4 and minus is less than 4. But again, that's a very subjective thing. Okay. Supposedly you are checking and next somebody else is coming and checking. So it's a little difficult for us to say plus and minus. So it's preferable to say 4. By 4, what do you mean? That it is not 5, correct? It is not normal.
Yes,
it's below normal. That much I know. Okay. Is this patient able to walk on his own?
He goes to the washroom, he needs support of one person.
Okay, but just go to the next slide. What I just want to see the power of the lower limb. What you have written? Yeah, you've written 4-. Okay. So what's the minimum power that is needed for a person to walk?
It should be against gravity. So 3.
3. So above 3, the patient will be able to walk. So that's what one thing that you have to remember. So 4- or 4+ does not make a difference. It is lesser than normal. Okay. And here you're finding that the distal is 3 and the proximal is 4. So it's a distal predominant weakness that you have.
Yes.
Is there a foot drop?
No foot drop, sir.
No foot drop because you're both plantar and dorsiflexion are both 3. So the foot cannot be dropped. If it is a drop, then one of them should be more than the other. So here, based on your findings, again, it's a distal weakness that is there. both in the upper limb and the lower limbs, correct?
Yes, sir, both in upper limb and lower.
History wise, you didn't have history in the upper limb, but in the examination, you found that there the upper limb is also a little weak. Okay, proceed.
Yes, sir. Coordination finger nose test he was able to perform. Knee heel test also he was able to perform. Involuntary movement.
Some other tests that are there for the coordination. You have the other tests also, not only finger nose. You have the other test in the upper limb also, which possibly again to do those tests, the power should be more than 3. Okay. So you're supposed to mention all those tests also, dysteriocokinesia or finger nose test. Okay. Or your rebound phenomena, etc., has to be checked.
Involuntary movements, bilateral fine tremors in the upper limb, no fasciculation seen.
So fine tremors, what are the causes of fine tremors?
Hyperthyroidism.
Okay.
Thyrotoxicosis.
How did you look at these fine tremors? As soon as we
stretched the hand, there were tremors. But ideally we would ask him to hold a paper by keeping the palms with the elbow extended and the paper will move.
Correct. So fine means you can't clinically see it. It's okay. So fine that you can't see it. So if you're able to see it, it is not a fine tremor. It's a core tremor.
Okay. Okay.
So coarse tremors, as you said, the causes could be hypothyroidism cause both fine and coarse, but predominantly fine. Okay. What are the other causes of tremors in the hands? As you said, essential tremors, correct? Then
withdrawal of alcohol and withdrawal alcoholism of alcohol, both.
Correct. Yes, then
even alcoholism.
Alcoholism can produce, correct? Good. Then
pill rolling tremors in Parkinsonism.
Okay, pill rolling. That's a classical in Parkinson's, correct?
What else?
Where else you can get tremors? Anxiety can produce tremor.
Yeah, anxiety can produce like.
Correct.
Yeah.
Drugs can produce tremor. Can you name some drugs which produce
beta
tremor?
Beta for asthma, salbutamol.
Correct. Beta agonist, very characteristic. Beta agonist like salbutamol. You take one inhaler, you'll have tremors, correct? Any other drugs, chronic usage can produce tremors? Any antipsychotic drug you know of which produces tremor?
Typical antipsychotics.
Can produce, yes. Lithium can produce tremors, correct? Okay, so these are the common causes which can produce tremors. Okay, so tremors, you're saying these almost all the antipsychotics, antiepileptics also can produce tremors, especially you have valproate, divalproate sodium is known to produce coarse tremors. Wilson's disease generally produces a proximal tremor. You have the wing beating tremor, not in the distal part, but tremors are important. Okay, in a neuropathy, if you have tremors, does it have a relevance or it is unrelated, you think?
I'm not
for undergraduate level, it may be a little difficult, but the neuropathy which produces tremors is CIDP. Okay. Yeah. CIDP produces tremors. That's just for an information. You don't have to tell it in your exams. I don't think so. Even if you tell it in the exam, it's not needed. Okay. This fine tremors could be due to certain causes. Okay, fine. Proceed.
Okay, reflexes, superficial reflex, corneal reflex present bilaterally, abdominal reflex present, cremastic reflex was not done. Plantar reflex showed no response. Reflex.
Why did the plantar reflex show no response?
It doesn't have sensation in S1 probably.
Oh, so S1... does not have sensation. So, okay. So any other way you tried to, okay. Anyways, that's only for Babinski. Fine. Okay. No response. Could be a thick sole. Yeah.
Deep reflex, biceps 2+, supinator 1+, triceps 1+ on both sides. Knee reflex was absent. Ankle reflex was absent.
Okay.
Impression bilaterally, plantar reflex is absent. Deep reflexes are absent in the bilateral lower limbs.
So what sort of neuropathy do you think this is? Only lower limb reflexes are gone, isn't it? Upper limbs are preserved. So it is not a demyelinating. Axonal neuropathy. So very important when you grade the reflexes. How do you grade these reflexes? Can you tell me the grading system of reflex?
Yes, sir. Like 2 plus is a normal biceps reflex. 1 plus is a normal brachioradialis reflex, sluggish. 0 is areflexia. And 3 plus is exaggerated. 4 plus is ill-sustained clonus. And 5 plus is a sustained clonus.
Is there 5 plus?
If 5.
Is there 5 grades? It's only 4 grades. No, there's nothing like ill-sustained clonus. Clonus is present or not.
Okay.
Ill-sustained clonus is a misnomer. There is no ill-sustained clonus. Okay.
Okay.
Clonus becomes 4 plus. Okay. Now here you said the reflexes are absent, 0. So anything you want to tell additionally, whenever you write 0 in your reflex, anything else you want to write it in bracket there? Mm-hmm. Before writing 0, around that 0, you'll have to put a bracket and write something. What is that?
If reflexes are not elicited, we have to write that the gendrasic manoeuvre or the
reinforcement.
Yeah.
So you're writing 0 there in bracket. You can write after reinforcement. So that tells the examiner that you know about reinforcement. Correct.
Yes, sir.
So what is reinforcement? Now you tell me.
Like for upper limb, we do the clenching for clenching of the teeth. Lower limb, we do the gendrasic. Or maybe what writing their name.
What is that gendrasic? What are you asking him to do?
Interlocking the fingers.
Interlocking the fingers and pulling. Correct.
Pulling.
Okay. What's the last one you said?
Like we can ask them to write their name in the air.
Okay. And why in the air? Why not in the book?
Like distract their attention from the.
Oh. Like, so this is knowledge, new knowledge acquiring. So distracting is the method how reinforcement works?
That is, no, one more method is that the A-alpha, like efferents, the signaling is increased or something.
Okay, A-alpha signaling is increased, not gamma.
Okay, I got confused, I don't know, sir.
Okay, so please remember reinforcement, the definition of reinforcement or what is the description of the reinforcement is a distal muscle contraction which enhances the tone and reflex of a particular muscle. Can you repeat? A distant muscle contraction which enhances the reflex as well as the tone. Correct? So by clenching your teeth or doing your gendrasics, what are you going to do? You're contracting some other muscle. Some other muscle is getting contracted. Is writing on the air contracting the muscle?
No, sir. No,
if it sir. Does, then it works as reinforcement, but I don't think so it does. So remember, by increasing the gamma motor efferents, so that's the traditional pathway where you have your gamma motor efferents are increased by a distal motor contraction, it happens. But the present belief is not only the gamma motor, as you said something about
Alpha.
What is that? Alpha. Where is this alpha located?
A alpha is anterior horn cell.
A alpha is anterior horn cell. Is there an inhibitory alpha anywhere?
No, interstitial.
So there is an inhibitory alpha that is there. So by doing this contraction of a distance muscle, that inhibitory alpha effect is nullified or the inhibitory alpha effect is decreased. And that produces this enhancement of the reflexes. So please remember you have to contract a muscle to produce this gendrasic. So you have to do that. Whenever you do these responses, you will have to do that. Okay. Yes, continue. What is this pronator drift? Why have you written it separately as pronator drift absent? What does that indicate to us?
That it's not UMN.
Mm-hmm. So all our examination was telling it as UMN was?
No.
It was always NMN. Na? It was always LMN. So you should not unnecessarily mention things which are not needed. And especially pronator drift is only for your stroke, isn't it?
Yes. It's yes,
a subtle stroke. Here we are not discussing stroke. So you don't have to mention a pronator drift. No harm in mentioning, but then you can keep it blank rather than saying absent.
Okay,
when you say it is absent, that means you were expecting it to be present, correct?
Okay, okay. Yes, sir, yes. Sir.
You can keep it blank. A normal case sheet can have it, but you can keep it blank. But When you write something on that, that means you were thinking something was needed. Okay. Yeah. Proceed.
Okay. Sensory system examination, it was absent in C6 to T1, L1 to L5, and S1 to S2 dermatomes bilaterally, that is spinothalamic sensation. S3 to S5 couldn't be elicited.
Why? It didn't cooperate.
Yeah.
Okay. So again, see here, we are talking about, see, when you say dermatomes, which sort of disease we are going to affect in dermatomes, dermatomal distribution?
Like the spinal disease.
Spinal disease or a nerve root disease, isn't it? Yes. Here, all our history, your reflexes were absent distally. What are we dealing with? That is dealing with peripheral neuropathy. So yeah. What should your sensory should come in the form of? How will you write it better?
Below elbow.
See that, below. Simple. Below ankle, the patient says it's completely absent. From ankle to the knee, he says it is 50% present. Something like that. Or you can use the simple word, graded sensory loss. Graded sensory loss present in the lower limbs, below the ankle, completely absent. Above that, there is a graded sensory loss. And above the knee, it is completely normal. Something like that you can say. Okay. Yes. And you're not expected to check the S3, S4 when the when the sensory loss is only in the below the ankle or below the knee. It won't come in this pattern. So it is better not to write it like this unless it is a spinal cord disease. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Upper limb, it's normal.
Upper limb, C6 to T1, like on below elbow, it was abnormal.
It's better to say that. Now I think, where is C6, where is T1?
Yes,
unnecessarily.
Yes,
okay. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Continue. Proceed.
Okay. Like the same poster thing in the same sense. Fine touch was absent.
Fine touch was absent. Okay.
Yeah, vibration sense was absent in lower limb, but present in the upper limbs.
Okay, fine.
Joint sense and position sense were intact.
Okay.
You're
saying joint and position were intact, but vibration was gone. Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir.
A little difficult because they go through the same
nerve. Yeah. So
maybe it's okay. Maybe it's early. It's okay. Fine. Yeah.
Wherever the sensation, the touch sensation was intact, that the cortical sensations were intact also.
Okay, what is this cortical sensation talking about? What are the cortical sensations? What do you mean by cortical? What is the relevance of?
It would be impaired in a parietal lobe stroke.
Okay, so they are the ones which would be having a relay center in the cortical region. So what are the cortical sensations you have mentioned?
Tactile localization, two-point discrimination, stereognosis, and graphesthesia.
Any other is there? One more is there?
No, I can't.
What is tactile localization meaning to you?
Like he's able to pinpoint and say where.
Correct. Two-point discrimination.
If he's able to discriminate that there are two separate sensations which are
stereognosis,
ability to recognize familiar objects with eyes closed.
Correct. Graphesthesia.
Ability to recognize written things on his back with his eyes closed.
On his back, not on his back. Back only it's seen in movies. Nobody writes on backs.
Okay.
Generally, write in the hands. Okay.
Okay.
On the back, it is Salman Khan writing on Sonam Kapoor, not on on the hand we write. Okay, just generally write it on the hand. So you write it on the hand, patient's eyes closed. Okay, there's one more cortical sensation called a sensory inattention.
Okay, sir.
You heard of it? Sensory inattention.
Yeah.
Have you heard of it? What does it mean to you? How do you check for it? Sensory inattention.
Like he neglects.
You're touching simultaneously.
Simultaneously.
Same points on both sides. Same points on both sides of the body, you're going to touch simultaneously. Okay. That's called a sensory inattention. And sometimes, as you said, the parietal lobe lesions, they can have something called as a perceptual rivalry. They'll not be able to feel one side at all. So that is the fifth cortical sensation. Okay. Okay. Romberg's sign could not be elicited because he could not stand. You said the power was 4, na?
Yeah, he told he cannot stand. He
Maybe he's ataxic a little. Okay, fine. Next slide.
Sir, I had a doubt about Romberg's sign. If immediately on standing he sways without his eyes closed.
Yes, we cannot test it.
Is it Romberg's positive?
No, we cannot test it. The patient should be stable with eyes closed. That's the basic prerequisite, that the patient should be stable with eyes closed. He should have a proper muscle power. He should have his, he should be able to stand with his eyes closed. If he is swaying with the eyes open itself, we are not supposed to test it afterwards, because that means there is a severe ataxia or a proximal muscle weakness. Only if he is able to stand properly with his eyes open, then you ask him to close.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Otherwise, you're not supposed. You can say that it was difficult to do because he had little clumsiness in standing. He said he could not stand without support, so we could not do it. Okay.
Yes, sir.
What is the, can you do Romberg sign in the upper limb?
No, I don't know, sir.
What does Romberg sign test, you're saying?
It tests posterior. It tests two out of the three things needed to stand, which is position sense.
What are the three things needed? I thought only two legs are needed.
Like posterior column, cerebellum, and visual sensation.
Does it check cerebellum? This is a mistake. Does it check cerebellum?
If we close eyes.
Yeah. If so we... Please understand the concept of Romberg's is, if supposedly there is a cerebellar involvement. Cerebellum is the very important thing. Na? The patient will become ataxic even with open eyes. Correct?
Yeah.
Cerebellum. There is totally open eyes also, they are ataxic. So there is no question of checking Romberg's there. Now the ataxia can be due to other sensories. What are the other sensories required to maintain the stability? One is cerebellum. Next is?
Joint and position.
Joint sense. Position, correct. Proprioception. Then?
Visual input.
Visual, very good. And? One more. Balance.
Eighth now, vestibular.
Vestibular, and then you should require the cortex also is needed. So these are the five structures that are there which require for your maintaining the balance. You have the cerebellum, you have the posterior column, large fibers or whatever you said. Then you had the vestibule, then the optic, and then there is the cortex that is there. Now, cerebellum patient is grossly ataxic. There is nothing to close your eyes. Now, why do you close your eyes? What helps us in closing the eyes? You're cutting off one of the problems. So if there is already one more problem, that becomes manifest. Okay. So when you're closing your eyes and the patient also has a peripheral neuropathy where the large fibers are getting involved or whatever, they become ataxic. So cerebellum is not tested with Romberg's. Romberg's is for the other. So a patient with cerebellar ataxia anyhow will be ataxic even with open eyes. So don't say cerebellum for Romberg's. Romberg's is basically for the posterior column. So if I ask you to close your hands and keep your hands straight up, if your proprioception is intact, what should happen to your hands? You should be able to maintain, isn't it? I ask you to close your hands. Supposedly I close my hands. What will happen if my proprioception is not intact? Or my joint position.
Or side to side.
What happened?
It'll sway up and down.
Sway, isn't it? It'll go down like this. What does it look like?
Snake.
Snake, correct. What is this movement? What is that movement described as? Slow writhing movement, it comes down.
Oh, athetosis.
Athetosis. So this is called a pseudoathetosis. True athetosis is seen in the basal ganglia disease. So here, if the joint position sense is gone in the upper limbs, you get this very classical pseudoathetosis in the upper limb. So you can test it, but again, you don't have to volunteer that information unless they ask you. Okay?
Yes.
Yes. Proceed.
Stance and gait couldn't be commented on. No signs.
Stance could have been commented on.
He didn't stand.
He didn't stand at all.
No, like he told he's feeling weak. Like,
okay, fine. Because you have to at least comment on the base, whether it's a broad base or a narrow base. Okay, fine. He could not. Okay.
No signs of cerebellar dysfunction. Okay. Like titubation. Okay. No signs of autonomic dysfunction. No signs of meningeal irritation.
Why those semicolons after that? It's a sentence or it's a paragraph?
No, it should be full stop.
Okay, it should be full stop. Yes, correct. Continue.
Review of other systems, respiratory system, bilateral normal vesicular breath sound over all lung areas, GI normal,
CVS. Supposedly, I'd say in a patient with neuropathy we are having, what is the relevance of examining each of these systems? What will it help you? Or what additional information will get from these systems?
If it's RS, probably asthma and the, like the medication maybe.
That is the tremors. No? We are talking about neuropathy.
Okay.
As you said, GB syndrome, the respiratory can get involved, isn't it? GB syndrome, you told me, respiratory paralysis and all, they can have all those things. So they can have muscle weakness, intercostal muscle weakness, diaphragmatic weakness could be there.
Yes, sir.
In the GIT system, okay, the patient who can't maybe maintain his airways, lower cranial nerves getting involved, they can have aspiration. So they could have evidence of that also. Per abdomen, if supposedly the patient has autonomic dysfunctions.
Yeah. You'll have diabetic gastroparesis. The abdomen, bowel sounds will be...
maybe sluggish. Okay, fine. Anything else? They can have, you may get palpable bladder. When you palpate the abdomen, patient says his urinary is totally normal. But then when you palpate, you might feel there is a bladder there. Patient is not complaining. What does it indicate? That the bladder is, autonomic dysfunction is there. A palpable bladder. That is an important thing. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Cardiovascular system, as we have already discussed, signs of autonomic dysfunction in the form of resting tachycardia, postural hypotension. That's all important in a case of autonomic nervous system involvement. Yes. Proceed. I think we are in the last slide. Oh, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So what's, I think
final summary, I think we can revise it a little.
Yeah. Clinically, it's paraparesis is peripheral nerves.
Clinically, can you tell me a little better word?
Autoimmune.
Paraparesis alone the patient has?
No, he has sensory deficit also.
So but you better tell it as what sort of problem it is. It's an acute or a subacute onset of bilateral sensory motor.
Sensory motor neuropathy.
Neuropathy or sensory motor symptoms in both the lower limbs. So paraparesis with distal sensory symptoms or distal sensory weakness and distal areflexia. Correct. So okay. That's your clinical diagnosis. Anatomically,
peripheral nerves.
Peripheral nerve is the site of lesion. And what sort of peripheral nerve involvement based on our etiology?
It's axonal.
Axonal. And again, please remember GB syndrome. Never mention when there is sensory involvement. Please don't get GB syndrome as a diagnosis there. So here the etiology is a acute or a subacute onset of axonal polyneuropathy, which is there. And the most common disease which presents with axonal polyneuropathy for us in clinical practice is diabetes. Okay, remember diabetes is the commonest cause for an axonal neuropathy that could be there. Only thing is here, this patient had it 6 months back, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So actually it is not an acute disease. He has recovered to a certain extent, but again, it has come back. Okay. So yes, he may not have completely recovered. So if you take that history from 6 months, so it becomes a chronic disease, correct?
Yes, sir.
So we have to little refine our history possibly. We'll have to ask him whether he was able to do everything that he was able to do prior to 6 months when he went home last time, or was there some symptoms still remaining? We'll have to ask him direct questions. Okay.
Because yes, he told he completely recovered, like he was perfectly fine after the treatment was given.
That's what we'll have to specifically ask certain questions. Was he able to climb upstairs? Was he able to climb downstairs? Was there a pins and needle sensations or whatever you had? Some symptoms might have remained. Very, very unlikely that it completely recovered with some B12, whatever supplement was given. Na? It's yes, little yes. Unlikely, but yes, maybe we'll have to just refine the history. I'm not saying that your history is wrong,
yes,
but if you say that there is a chronic disease, then our diabetes would be the first diagnosis that would be there. So yes, we are dealing with a polyneuropathy. So what are the common causes of polyneuropathy in practice, what we get? So what are the common causes that you want to rule out. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Diabetes.
Diabetes is the number one, correct?
Then leprosy.
Leprosy, does it produce polyneuropathy? Polyneuropathy means multiple nerves getting involved, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Leprosy generally produces single nerves on single one side. Okay. Generally produces mononeuropathies or something called as mononeuritis multiplexa. You heard of that word?
Yes, sir.
Mononeuritis multiplexa. Different nerves in different parts. So leprosy does not produce polyneuropathy. Okay. So the first cause we said is diabetes. Second, always important, alcohol. Always remember alcohol. This patient doesn't have it, but alcohol is a very important cause of neuropathy. The third cause, as we have discussed that time, is the nutritional causes. Yes. So remember nutritional causes, like you have B12 or your thiamine deficiency, various nutritional deficiencies can produce. The fourth cause that you have to always remember is one more chronic disease. One more chronic disease that we have. The diabetics are prone to develop that chronic disease.
Chronic kidney disease.
Yes, very important. Chronic kidney disease. You should always remember this. CKD is a very important cause of neuropathy. If you do not evaluate, we'll miss that. So CKD is an important cause. Then all the other neuropathies are less common. If a younger patient comes, you should always consider a family history is there. You can consider a familial neuropathy. Sometimes you have infections which can produce neuropathy. Like earlier days, we had syphilis. Present day, the disease that we have equivalent to syphilis.
AIDS, HIV.
AIDS, HIV produces neuropathy. You have large number. Supposedly a patient is tuberculosis. If the patient develops neuropathy, it is due to drug intake, correct? Drug intake. If somebody is a farmer who has been working in the fields for long, exposed to?
OP.
So toxins can produce neuropathies. And as you said, acute neuropathies are always demyelination, like your GB syndrome. And a young female comes with recurrent neuropathies, history of psychiatric illness, abdominal pain, always remember
porphyria.
Okay, always remember porphyria there. Never forget porphyria. Then you have the other causes also. So here we have possibly a chronic neuropathy, subacute to chronic neuropathy, axonal neuropathy, and it's almost always diabetes is the disease that can produce. After diabetes, it is CKD is the second cause for axonal neuropathy. So what are the investigations that you would want to do in this patient?
Blood sugars.
Yes,
blood sugar. I also want to rule out anemia.
Okay, you want to rule out anemia and you want to get a peripheral smear. That's very important. Peripheral smear will tell you if there is a B12 deficiency, etc. Peripheral smear will tell you whether macrocytic is there or something like that. Sometimes you have a lead poisoning where you can get a microcytic picture with basophilus stippling. Lead poisoning produces a motor neuropathy. Patient can come with wrist drop. Painters are exposed to that. And HbA1c you want to do. HbA1c we want to do. And vitamin B12 levels, correct, because he's a pure vegetarian, you want to do. Creatinine, always never forget that. Always get a creatinine whenever the neuropathy is there. And for the nerve, the specific test would be NCV. NCV would come first, okay? Nerve conduction study would be better. Why MRI spine? You're not suspecting a spinal cord disease, isn't it? So MRI would not be of any help. Lumbar puncture, only if you're suspecting?
GP.
Yeah, what do you get in the lumbar puncture in GP syndrome?
Albuminocytological dissociation.
Wow, albuminocytological dissociations, correct. What is that? What do you mean by that albuminocytological dissociation? Can you tell me what is albuminocytological dissociation?
There's too much protein and too less number of cells.
Okay, normally the protein is increased whenever the cells is increased, correct? Normally. But here, the protein is increased, but the cells are not increased. Where is this protein coming from? The cells are not there. So where is the protein coming from?
Antibody.
The myelination, isn't it? Where are these radicals? You said radicals, isn't it?
Okay.
Where are these radicals bathing in? They are freely bathing in the CSF space.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So these radicals are getting demyelinated. So the myelin increases. So normally we have 0 to 5 cells only in the GB syndrome CSF. But the protein will be very much elevated. So that's a very important test that you can do. Okay. And why do you want to give steroids?
No, like
which neuropathy steroids is the treatment of choice?
Autoimmune, like
which autoimmune? Yeah.
GB.
No, please remember GB steroids are contraindicated.
Okay.
It is indicated in the other one, not AIDP.
CIDP.
Always remember CIDP, the treatment of choice is steroids. It responds beautifully to steroids. And if there is some autoimmune disease like vasculitis, etc., younger patients, you would always want to rule out that vasculitis, etc., that can also respond to steroids. IVIG can be given for acute or chronic neuropathies. Acute neuropathies, you can also do plasmapheresis. That's a treatment that is to be done for acute GB syndrome, not in chronic. Okay. Yes, any other slide is there?
No, sir. That's all.
Okay. Any doubts or clarifications regarding this case or any other relevant thing?
If there are any doubts, please put it up in the chat section.
Okay, so generally in your neuro examination, they ask you to demonstrate, reflexes. So you have to be very clear in demonstration of reflexes. Maybe, I think today we are already crossing to us. So maybe in one of the future classes, maybe I'll show you the reflexes. Again, remember the root values of the reflexes. You have to be very clear on that. Root value of the reflexes, always remember the simple thing starts from the lower limb, the ankle reflex. What's the root value? Himanshu, you're there?
Yeah. Yes, sir. Ankle is S1, S2.
Ankle is S1, S2. Knee jerk is?
Knee jerk is L2, L3, L4.
L3, 4. So you can remember 1, 2 for the ankle, 3, 4 for the knee jerk.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Then come to the upper limb.
Brachioradialis and biceps both are C5, C6. Triceps, C6, C7.
For the biceps and for the triceps, it is 7, 8. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Do not get confused. Making the mistakes in the root values is something considered as very basic. So you should not be making a mistake on that. Very important is the plantar reflex. They ask you to demonstrate. What's the root value of plantar reflex?
L5S1.
L5S1. L5 is the, you stimulate which dermatome?
We stimulate the S1 dermatome and the flexion is through the L5.
Is it flexion is through the L5 or extension? No. Normally is flexion. Agreed.
Yes, sir.
Normally is S1 only. When you have an extensor response, your EHL coming up, na, that is due to the...
That is S1, yeah.
That is
L5.
That is L5, okay. So you're not wrong in saying L5 S1, but S1 is also okay. So again, they ask you to demonstrate the plantar reflex. Always remember plantar reflex, how do you demonstrate it? What do you use for it?
We use blunt objects.
Okay, it should be a blunt object. Key. Ideally, use a key.
Yeah.
Okay, key. And then you're going to firmly stroke right up. You should never cross the first toe. You should never cross the first toe there. You should keep your stimulus before that. And what's the normal response?
Normal is plantar flexor.
Plantar flexion. Okay, what are the components of Babinski sign? A very common question they ask you.
Yes, sir. Great toe extension, fanning of other toes, flexion ankle, flexion knee, then contraction tensor fasciae latae.
Okay, contraction of the tensor fasciae latae. Where is that located?
Lateral aspect of the thigh.
Okay, so we have to expose, whenever you do the plantar reflex, we have to expose up to the hip. That's very important that you have to know. So you have to expose there and you can see the contraction or you can feel for the contraction. Okay, so what is minimum Babinski? Minimum Babinski reflex. Out of all these components, which is called as minimum Babinski?
I think contraction of tensor.
Contraction of the tensor fasciae latae is called as minimum Babinski. Okay. What about if the lower limb is totally amputated? What do we do? We can't elicit the plantar.
Opposite limb.
We want to check it in that side only.
That's upper limb.
Upper limb, we can do the equivalence, yeah. Isn't it? You can do it in the Hoffman sign or the Wattenberg sign. This could be done in the upper limbs that could be checked for. So these are the things that you do. Now, can you reinforce plantar?
Okay.
If you're not getting the plantar reflex by your standard way, is there a method of reinforcing?
There are other methods.
Very good. Why can't you reinforce a plantar? Because reinforcement is a mechanism only for?
Deep reflexes.
Deep tendon reflexes. Why is that? Deep tendon reflexes are? What type of reflex in contrast to?
They are monosynaptic.
Correct. Monosynaptic reflexes. All your deep tendon reflexes are monosynaptic reflexes, whereas the plantar reflex or the superficial reflexes are polysynaptic reflexes. So reinforcement word cannot be used, but yes, we can divert their attention like what you said that time. You can divert their attention, but you could do the plantar by alternate ways. The other ways of doing the plantar. What are they? What is the most or the best way of doing the plantar?
Like there's Oppenheim's.
Okay, Oppenheim's is there, correct?
Then there is Gordon's technique.
Gordon's, correct?
Then like there is Chaddock's technique.
What's a most best way if I ask you to elicit plantar? It was described by the disciple of Babinski. Babinski was a great neurologist, though. The actual sign which was described was much later by his disciple. It's called as a Chaddock's reflex.
Chaddock.
So how do you do this Chaddock? Chaddock's is supposedly the best way to elicit the plantar. How do you do the Chaddock's?
Like we outer aspect.
So you're going outer aspect. So normally we're stimulating on the sole. Here we're going to go to the outer aspect. Okay. Outer aspect. Now, what you say this, you're going to the outer aspect, your Oppenheim's, how do you do it? Oppenheim's
is on the
shin. You're going to get your knuckles down the shin, correct? Yes. Then your Gordon's, Schaeffer's, you're going to squeeze the tendo-Achilles, you're going to squeeze the calf muscle. There are various methods. So how do these work?
I'm not sure, sir.
Okay, see, what is the reflexogenic zone? What's the reflexogenic zone for the normal plantar?
S1.
S1 is the reflexogenic zone. Now, by stimulating all these other parts, the tibia, the calf, what are you doing? You're increasing the
density.
Reflexogenic zone.
Okay.
You understood?
Yes, sir.
You're increasing the reflexogenic zone. And again, remember in upper motor neuron disease, there is a separate group of fibers which is producing this extensa plantar. Remember in UMN disease, all superficial reflexes are lost. So plantar flexion is lost. Correct. This extensor plantar is coming due to a different mechanism. It is not a opposite of a normal reflex. In UMN disease, all superficial reflexes are lost. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Correct. So yes, plantar normal reflex is lost. This extensor is coming from a different mechanism. Okay. We have something called as a parapyramidal fibers. I don't think so. You should know about it. I mean, you can read about it when you're free and relaxed, not when your exams are close by. So by stimulating a different dermatome, we are going to increase the reflexogenic zone. And that is how you get this extensor plantar. So again, this is asked in your exam. They ask you to demonstrate this also. So you have to know a bit of the plantar reflex. So that's the first and most important thing that they ask you to demonstrate in the nervous system is the reflexes. Second thing is the tone. So the tone in the upper limb, tone in the lower limb. Any other questions? If you have, you can put it in the chat. No. Okay. So the tone in the upper limb, as I've already explained to you, biceps tone, how do you check? And the brachioradialis tone, how do you check? And how do you check the tone of triceps? So that's how you check for. In the upper limb, the power, if they ask you, they ask you to do the deltoid power. So how do you check for the deltoid power?
Deltoid, there are like three different fibers.
Hmm.
Anterior, middle, and posterior. So we would have to check abduction and extension. Okay. And so
most importantly, you check for is abduction, isn't it?
Okay.
So we, after the initial part of the abduction is by the
supraspinatus.
So from there onwards is the deltoid. So that's how you check for the deltoid. So in the upper limb, the common muscle they ask you is deltoid. In the lower limbs, the common muscle they ask you to check for the power is iliopsoas. So how do you check for the power of iliopsoas?
It's a hip flexion.
Okay, so how do you do this? How do you demonstrate this?
Hip flexion. Like ask him to lie supine maybe and start with grade 3 power. by asking him to flex the hip against gravity and then place hand and provide resistance again.
Very importantly, you have to flex the knee. You can't flex the hip without flexing the knee. Then yes. knee doesn't bend down, isn't it? You have to flex the knee. That is very important. And then you're going to put your hand on the hip and ask him to flex it onto the abdomen. It's done in supine position. So if you want to eliminate gravity, how do you check for hip flexion eliminating gravity?
Left lateral position.
Lateral position. Either of the yeah. lateral positions, you can check. That's how you can eliminate gravity. So these are the two muscle powers they ask you in the exam. One is the deltoid. One is the iliopsoas. These are commonly asked. Other things also can be asked. But these are common ones which you're expected to know. And the root value for each of them. C5, L1. So that's about the motor examination which they ask you in the exam. What else is asked? The cranial nerves, some of them are asked, especially your confrontation technique for 3-4-6, the second nerve. Then the 3-4-6 nerves. How do you check for superior oblique? How do you check for the right superior oblique?
Right superior oblique is right side up and out.
Right superior oblique. Where should the right eye see?
Okay, up and down and out.
Down and? Remember, whenever the side we say, if I say right superior oblique, the right eye should see the tip of the nose.
Okay. Oh yeah, so, cheating.
So what should be the movement? In and?
Down,
isn't it? In and down. So superior oblique, whenever we ask you your movement, if I say right superior oblique, you're going to ask the patient to look at the same eye should be seen, seeing the tip of the nose. That much you remember. If I'm asking you right superior oblique, the right eye should come and see the tip of the nose. If I'm asking the left superior oblique, the left eye should see the tip of the nose. That much you have to remember. Okay. Then the facial nerve, very important nerve. I think that's a full class. I think there was already a discussion on Bell's palsy and facial nerve. I think so. But a facial nerve is a very important nerve. They ask you, they keep it a short case also for you. Maybe that's a little long discussion. Maybe we'll have it on some other time. Any other doubts? I think there was. Why can't we give plasmapheresis after giving IVIG? It treatment failure. You can give it sequentially. You can give plasmapheresis and IVIG sequentially. But if you give IVIG and immediately do the plasmapheresis, all the IVIG is lost. You can do it sequentially, okay? Why steroids are contraindicated in GB syndrome? GB syndrome, it's believed to be a B-cell mediated disorder in contrast to CIDP, where it's a T-cell mediated disorder. And steroids work wonderfully, both for B-cell and T-cell. They work wonderfully against cell-mediated immunity. Whereas antibody-mediated immunity or antibody-related disorders, the best treatment would be neutralizing by giving a immunoglobulin or removing the antibodies by doing plasmapheresis. So that's why plasmapheresis and IVIG is better for GB syndrome. And by giving steroids, the recovery of GB syndrome is delayed. Okay, that's the mechanism. Enumerate other methods of eliciting plantar. Please remember only two or three methods. Your Chadox is the simplest one, going on the lateral aspect of the foot. Next is the open hams, that you're coming down the shin. Then you have the Gordons and Schaffers, that is the calf muscle and the squeezing of the tendo Achilles. So these are the four methods you can remember. There are other methods. Bings is there. You have Stock Martens is there. Many others are there, but four, if you remember, is enough. Which book to refer CNS clinical aspects for history and examination? I can't say any other book other than my book. Okay. There's a book called as Insider's Guide of Clinical Medicine. Examination things are given well with images. You can refer. That's been written by me. Okay. I should not say that, but the other books are also good. The other books are good. The other books are also good, but they're a little elaborate. Possibly my book is little concise. That's only I can say. But you can refer any book, okay? Best, if you're a postgraduate, obviously there's a book called as Bickerstaff. It's a small book, Bickerstaff, which gives you thoroughly about neuro examination, one of the wonderful books. And then neuro history and examination, there's a wonderful book called as De Jong. Again, that's for the postgraduate book, or maybe if you're in the first year or second year you can read that. In spinal shock, which returns first? It's the bulbocavernous reflex. Bulbocavernous reflex is the first to return back after spinal shock. Are there any other questions?
I guess that's all, sir.
That's all?
It was indeed a very comprehensive. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I guess
that's all. Okay.
It was indeed a very comprehensive clinical class, sir. It was a wonderful discussion, and we could learn a lot from this, sir. Thank you so much, Dr. Archit, sir, for your valuable inputs. And it was a great presentation by Mr. Himanshu, and Himanshu, we could learn a lot because of the well-prepared presentation. Thank you. I thank all the attendees for their active participation. And thank you.
Thank you, sir. You very much.
Good evening and good night.
Good night, sir.
Best of luck.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.